Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for taking time out of your day to join us. Welcome to Monitoring Indoor Air Quality. First off, I just want to extend or say a big thank you to our friends at KMC Controls for their partnership, for inviting us to be here today, and for putting on a really nice event. I hope everybody's enjoying themselves. It's really nice to be with you all.
Yeah, as everyone said, it's good to be in person again.
Yeah. Barring the fact that none of my clothes fit anymore, but we won't talk about that. So I'm Maya Holzmer. I'm a sales engineer for Automation Components, and joining me is my colleague Bill Koopsch. He is our Vice President of New Product Development. For those of you that are not familiar with ACI, we are a sensor and transmitter manufacturer. We make and provide products for sensing areas such as temperature, relative humidity, pressure, current, gas detection. We make an interface line, a wireless line, and a variety of accessories. We've been in business since 1991, and we do all of our manufacturing at our headquarters in Middleton, Wisconsin. And today, Bill and I would like to talk with you guys a little bit about, you know, sensors and transmitters and the important role that they play in monitoring indoor air quality. And how have we seen that role change recently, or more recently, to include a new focus on occupancy safety as well as occupant comfort in a building? What kind of parameters should be considered when we're talking about indoor air quality? What solutions are available to monitor for those? And what kinds of changes might we all see coming down the road?
So, in a couple of the presentations yesterday, I mean, everyone was talking about indoor air quality has been part of our industry, right? This part is not new to us, but the whole fun of COVID, right? It brought a new awareness. It bumped the priority of indoor air quality higher in our priorities at this point, right? Everyone wants to make sure occupants are safe. People are concerned, you know, can the building ventilation systems be a negative impact and spread viruses and stuff more than what people might think and that type of thing. So there's definitely a different focus, I would say, for indoor air quality in our industry at this point. And I think, you know, some of it is, I think the building owners are starting to kind of understand that it's no longer all about operational efficiency and money saving on how efficient can you run your equipment. We really need to pull back and start understanding how our occupants are feeling in these buildings. Are the buildings safe enough? And how can we convince people to come back to these public buildings again and give them that assurance that the air systems there are safe for them? You know, COVID also brought that highlight to a lot of you. I'm assuming a lot of you guys experienced some of it with buildings shutting down and then trying to recommissioning again and finding out that, oh, that filter probably hasn't been changed in a year, 2 years, right? These dampers are frozen shut. Even if we wanted to pull in 100% outside air, we can't even do that. We're lucky if we can get 5-10%. And a lot of this has also been highlighted in schools, right? All these older buildings, and there's been several studies about the performance of kids, performance of office workers, right? If you don't have a good quality air environment, everything kind of goes down. Performance goes down, learning goes down. And, you know, so all of this has just kind of, again, popped to the top of, no, this is really important stuff that we know about, but now I think the rest of the communities that we deal with are starting to get a better understanding of the importance of indoor air quality.
One thing I wanted to mention when I started was this is meant to be very casual. If you have any questions, comments, anecdotes, stories, things that you're seeing, we would be very interested in hearing about those. So please, let's make it a two-way conversation if you like. With regard to pollutants in a building, they are primarily going to come from two sources, outdoor sources and indoor sources. Outdoor sources are primarily made up of particulate matter, coming from things like vehicle emissions, industrial or agricultural processes that could be going on around outside of the building, power generation, or if you happen to live in a geographical area that experiences wildfires, you might have wildfire smoke. And all these things can make their way into buildings in a variety of ways. Through natural ventilation, if your doors and windows are open, it can come in through your mechanical ventilation, through your filter system, through your ductwork, and it can also infiltrate the building through the envelope if there are breaks in door seals or window seals. All of that comes in, mixes with the indoor pollutants, which are primarily, you know, VOCs or formaldehyde, which are generated by the building materials that were used to build the structure. Any kind of equipment that you might have inside, whether it be office equipment or various school equipment, or cleaners or chemicals that are used to clean the building or in processes that happen inside of the building. And one of the biggest sources for indoor pollutant is the occupants of the building, who are exhaling CO2 or coming to work wearing cologne, perfume, hairspray, any variety of potentially odorous substances. And so the goal is to be able to exhaust as much of this back out of the building in order to improve the indoor air quality as you possibly can. So this slide, for me, was a little bit eye-opening. It's a few basic statistics with regard to the financial impact of indoor air quality. And the fact that problems with IAQ, things like so-called sick building syndrome, have a significant health and financial impact on the community as a whole. Poor indoor air quality is going to lead to higher incidence of respiratory disease, allergies, asthma, poor worker performance, poor student performance, absenteeism. The EPA estimates that poor indoor air quality affects anywhere from 30 to 50% of commercial buildings in the United States today, leading to 125 million lost school days and up to 10 million lost work days each year. So the financial impact of being able to improve indoor air quality is estimated to be in the billions of dollars. Savings from reducing those incidences of sick building syndrome, respiratory disease, et cetera, and improving attendance in both schools and the workplace. And a couple weeks ago, I don't know if anybody saw it, but our friend Tim Vogel had posted a question on LinkedIn, and it was something along the lines of, what is hindering a broader adoption of indoor air quality solutions across our industry? And I read the answers, and they all centered around a couple of main themes. You know, basically, people don't know how to utilize or what to do with some of the information that can help you in studying indoor air quality, like, you know, VOC levels, particulate matter levels, et cetera. And then, you know, even if you know where to implement or what to do, there's really no global standard that addresses indoor air quality. You know, there are some geographic standards that we're starting to see crop up. Bill's gonna talk about some of those. But, you know, which standard do you follow? Do you need to follow a standard? What do you do with all of this information in order to improve the situation in your building? And I had kind of a personal, just for me personally, a story with regard to this, because as I was trying to think about this, I'm trying to wrap my head around it in practical ways that, you know, relate to myself. And several years ago, I went into the office and I walked in one day and I was like, what is going on? Well, our maintenance person, for some reason or another, I don't know, maybe there was just a deal at Costco, but had gotten, I don't even know how many of those Glade plug-in inserts, and had put one in every office and probably at every other outlet along the hallways. And they weren't all the same smell either. They were just a random variety of Glade plugins all over. And, you know, I thought, well, those things have a coverage area on them, and I think you're grossly underestimating what that is. But it was terrible. And I have a real smell sensitivity. I can't go through perfume departments, at department stores. It affects me. So I could not work that day. I had a terrible headache. I felt awful. I went in and I talked to my boss, and he's like, he didn't even smell it. It didn't even bother him. And so I lost a whole day's work for something that was not affecting a lot of other people. But we don't know what each person is sensitive to, what affects each person in a different way. Had there been at that time something like a VOC sensor or an indicator, something tangible that I could have pointed to and said, this doesn't look so good, and this is why I don't feel very well today, that potentially could have, you know, led to some changes.
And we still don't know what original smell they were trying to cover up with it, so.
No, it didn't. We didn't need the Glade plugins. I think somebody was just like, ooh, that looks like a good idea. But anyway, I mean, back to what we're talking about here. And, you know, all of us know that taking steps in a building to improve air quality, whether it be improving filtration, adding filtration, increasing ventilation, whatever that is, it costs money. It increases costs to a building owner. But in looking at this slide, you know, as we're talking to these building owners or these gatekeepers who are maybe pushing back and saying, you know, how can we afford to make these changes? How can we afford to do what we need to do to give a better level of indoor air quality? It seems to me, in looking at what's being lost and considering personal experiences, the question that we should be asking back to them is, well, how can you afford not to make these changes?
So like I said, so IAQ isn't anything new. There's been several standards around for a long period of time. LEED, I think everyone's familiar with LEED. LEED's been around since 93, right? And, you know, that's the framework for a healthy, highly efficient, and cost savings green buildings. My kind of interpretation is, you know, LEED's been much more focused on the energy efficiency of buildings. And, you know, I would say up till last couple of years before COVID hit, right? The pendulum probably swung a little bit far one way on the energy efficiency and trying to make buildings as tight as possible, trying to optimize your fans, your building costs to get every ounce of money savings out of it. And, you know, I think that led to some of the cost of indoor air quality, right? With sick building syndromes and you know, just personal experiences like Maya. So, you know, in 2014, the WELL building standards became established. And so this was a standard that, you know, people worked with scientists, doctors, architects, and wellness thought leaders from around the globe to come up with these standards. And there was a little bit, there was much more focus on personal well-being in the building environment on that. In 2017, Fitwell standards were established. And these were originally worked on by the CDC and the US General Services Administration, right? And they have a much broader focus with the Fitwell standard on building and community health and well-being, right? So people knew indoor air quality has been an issue, right? And they're concerned about occupant safety, but, you know, so we've seen these standards get established. One of the more recent ones is the RESET standard that started in Shanghai, China. Mainly came out of all the smog air pollution going on. The RESET standards are more focused on the actual sensing and monitoring and reporting of the building environment in real time. So it's not just a commissioning startup and check it every once in a while. It's constant review of the data to see if your building is performing within the parameters. And you know, there are other things like the Living Building Challenge that was initially started in 2006. I think they're on version 4 of that now. Right, and that one has turned into probably one of the most rigorous building standards out there that, you know, focuses on green and health and well-being. So like we know, this is nothing new, but the events of this last year and a half have really kind of popped it again to the top of what are the people in the buildings really experiencing and seeing, right? And, you know, ASHRAE's had standards. There's more than 62.1 on there. There's several standards there. ASTM has a CO2-based standard. And what we're seeing now, and someone had mentioned it in one of the breakout sessions yesterday about, well, if you want to get some of these things changed and get people to pay attention to it, you need to start working at the local government level. And with the focus on learning and schools, and there's been studies by UC Berkeley and Harvard about the effects of poor air quality on students, we're starting to see state legislations pass laws to focus more on indoor air quality. These are mainly kind of focused on ventilation with CO2 monitoring. So the state of California at the end of last year passed legislation. So every classroom in the state of California is eventually supposed to have a CO2 monitor in that room. They have to have, you know, ventilation systems working. Part of the requirement of the CO2 monitoring is data logging. They want to see data over a week's period to see if levels have spiked in those classrooms. They've set their set point for CO2 at 800 ppm. So part of that effect for demand control ventilation is, you know, they're dropping that CO2 standard so they get more air pushing through those rooms. Again, you still have that balancing point of how much is it costing you to run? Is your equipment even set up to handle some of this new added airflow and that type of thing? But it's being required at this point. Nevada has adopted just about the exact same legislation this year, and there are similar bills in New Jersey and New York at this point, right? So it's gonna hit the coast, and it's gonna start working its way inward. And even at the federal level, so along with all the other stimulus money that's been issued, there is a bill in Congress right now, the Reopen and Rebuild America School Act of 2021, which would set aside even more money for schools to improve their infrastructures. And I'm guessing it's going to follow along with what probably California's put down there and involved more stringent CO2 standards in occupied spaces and better ventilation. As some people alluded to yesterday, there's gonna be a burden of proof that's gonna be expected out of this, right? With the California stuff and having to trend your CO2 levels in any classroom, right? People are gonna want proof that these systems are working and that we've made an impact to that environment in those schools or those office buildings.
So there's a variety of solutions available out there right now to help improve indoor air quality. And oftentimes it's a combination of solutions that make the best sense for an overall plan. Each of them come with their own pros and cons. You know, we've got dilution, filtration, humidification, cleaning, and disinfection. Cleaning and disinfection, you're talking about things like UV irradiation or ionization systems and others. That is going to go, you know, a long way or can help to reduce viruses and bacteria that are in the air. But it will not address things like high CO2 levels, other targeted gases that could be in the space, or particulate matter. Maintaining proper RH levels in your building can help reduce the spread of microbials, and it can also help with energy efficiencies. But increasing RH levels or increased RH levels can lead to mold growth, and some of your building materials may not be amenable to either a higher or a lower RH level, thus causing, you know, potential breakdown to happen faster than it normally would. Filtration, adding or improving filtration in ductwork, that's going to help address particulates like dust, pollen, debris, things of that nature. But that, you know, can put a strain on existing equipment such as fans and motors, affect your pressurization in the building, and, you know, likely require additional maintenance. It also doesn't reduce CO2 or other gases that could be in the space. Which brings us to dilution. And the easiest way to improve every aspect of indoor air quality is to increase ventilation by bringing in more outside air. It reduces microbials, it reduces particulate matter, it reduces gases such as CO2 and other targeted gases. But the con there, or doing that brings with it higher energy costs and potentially higher equipment costs depending on what you're dealing with in the system. So there's always going to be a balancing act between improving indoor air quality and energy efficiency. In most parts of the United States, just adding more outdoor air into a space is going to significantly increase your utility costs. Bill and I are from the upper Midwest, and there's a good 9+ months out of the year there where you're going to spend quite a bit of money to either heat and humidify your air or cool and dehumidify the air. So effective ventilation strategies require effective monitoring and feedback to the building management system through the use of sensors and transmitters. ACI has a variety of solutions to help with different parameters. CO2, up here, CO2 being the gold standard for demand control ventilation. And we have a plethora of solutions. These three are some of the more popular that are chosen to help with demand control ventilation. We have duct mount installation units, space mount with LCD display, as I believe some of the new standards in California are requiring that there be a display.
Right, along with that data trending, there's required to be some type of visual indicator with that device in the classroom to be able to essentially notify the teacher or anyone in there that the levels may not be acceptable. There, right, which brings up a challenge of, okay, you see something spike, what do? Are you supposed to leave? I mean, it, with CO2. right. And at 800 PPM as your control point on that alarm, then, right, it doesn't take long to hit that. And we had a conversation this morning of, the notification is nice in some extent, but if people don't understand how the building systems work, how ventilation works, right, that it's natural to kind of see some of this, right? And they don't need to panic. They probably don't even need to do anything unless they see that yellow or red indication for days, right? Or multiple hours in a row. Then they may, can go find their maintenance people and say, hey, something doesn't seem right in this classroom space. But yeah, visual indication and trending are the two big requirements for CO2 in the California and Nevada legislation.
Yeah. And as mentioned, CO2 being the gold standard for driving the demand control ventilation, and now we are talking about, increasing ventilation, bringing more outside air in. Well, this function is always going to be critical. And now it could be considered even more important with regard to energy efficiency, because you could theoretically use CO2 sensors to drive the ventilation just to the certain parts of the building where it's needed, as opposed to the building as a whole, in order to improve the IAQ and occupant health, but also maintain your energy efficiency.
So now some of the fun stuff, right? So CO2, there are standards around it, right? It's pretty well defined for demand control ventilation. Well, these other building standards, right, and EPA, OSHA, they call out safety levels for other things. So volatile organic compounds, so VOCs, particulate matter is a large concern. And some of the challenges with these is, okay, you start monitoring these parameters, what do you do with them, right? There's no real direct guidance that at what level of VOCs do I need to bring in more ventilation or not? And how does that compare with my CO2 reading? Can they be in conflict of each other, right? So there's a challenge out there for all of us on trying to kind of weld together these strategies where you're trying to balance all these different environmental parameters and your energy efficiency and that type of thing. But at ACI, so you know, we've brought in a line of IAQ sensors. So we have TVOC that can sit in a room space or a duct space. We have particulate matter, both particulate matter 10 and 2.5. And then we have sensors that can handle other type of gases, CO, ozone, radon, those type of things that, like on CO, I'm starting to see more and more legislation pop through the states to require CO monitoring in schools. Surprisingly, it's not something that is necessarily required everywhere. Right, yeah. So PM's kind of one of my interesting things because, you know, we're getting calls for it. Hey, do you guys have a PM sensor? And we're like, sure, you need 10, 2.5. No one really knows. Sure, 2.5 is kind of the new global standard. The 2.5 micron particle size is the ones that they've determined are really critical in causing respiratory injuries and cancer. So there's much more of a focus on trying to monitor that and respond with filtering and that type of thing. But we had an instance from a customer in Minnesota who just installed some of our PM sensors and they were trending them, and all of a sudden they saw a spike. And they called us and it's like, are you sure your sensors are working properly? Because all, you know, things were fine and all of a sudden it's starting to spike. And our tech service department was talking with the customer and it's like, okay, so where are you guys at? And it's like, Minnesota, and this was a couple of months ago, and it's like, Canadian wildfires are going on and smoke's starting to drift down, right? And the people said, yeah, they kind of sent us that photo of what it looked outside, right? You could see the smoke haze out there. And we're like, well, if you can you contact your local National Weather Station, they have their published PM readings and see what those are doing. So here's the PM line, and all the timing actually does correspond that as the smoke from the wildfires came down, the outside air PM levels spiked, the inside monitoring spiked correspondingly, right? And great example and a teaching tool for people. So here's how you can use PM monitoring for your ventilation, right? You can monitor it on your outside air intake. You could have something outside the building, right? If we're being told to bring in as much outside air as possible, does it make sense to do it all the time? Here's a case where no, I've got indicators now saying, why do I want to pollute my indoor air with all these smoke particles in here, right? So again, there's no true hard guidance of if A happens and B happens, then you do C. So these are some of the things we have to figure out as controlling buildings. And then likewise, you can actually place PM further downstream past your filterings to be that secondary check of, is my filtering actually good enough, right? Am I removing enough particles out of that airstream to make the classrooms, the building space acceptable for the occupants?
And then finally, temperature and relative humidity, which we have a wide variety of different configurations to monitor for each of those parameters. And they have been employed since probably the beginning of building automation as far as helping maintain people's comfort levels in a space. But now, and Bill, you can probably add a little bit to this, we're seeing them being utilized more and more often to help calculate dew point in order to make sure that there's condensation that isn't potentially going on inside of a building.
Right, yeah, 62.1 has changed their terminology away from relative humidity to dew point as the moisture control information at this point.
And then finally, pressure. And pressure is not an indicator of indoor air quality, but it is important it can serve a lot of purposes. Help you know when your filters are getting clogged, when they might need to be changed or maintained. If you're increasing your ventilation into the building, bringing in a lot more outdoor air, you want to make sure that you're maintaining the proper pressurization of the building so that your doors aren't propping open and you're losing the air that you are spending money to condition. So pressure, you know, always goes hand in hand with everything that we're trying to do here. And finally, you know, just a few thoughts or things to sum up. You know, as we all know right now, IAQ or improving IAQ and being able to actually prove and document that we are improving indoor air quality in a space is of the utmost importance because it can help go a long way towards encouraging the continued occupation of spaces. You know, can get people back into their office buildings, get people going out to restaurants, going to theaters, arenas, whatever public spaces they might need to go to, schools, of course. You know, parents need to get back to work, kids need to be back in the schools where they learn the best. So I think, you know, we will likely continue to see increased standards and legislation focusing on indoor air quality. We'll likely continue to see more different kinds of sensors, new kinds of things that can be deployed to help in those efforts. And as always, a focus on improved ventilation and increased ventilation in spaces. If you guys have not come by to visit with Bill and I at our table, please do. You know, we'd be happy to talk more about these, show you some of the samples. We have things on the table that we can take a look at and talk about, or discuss any application questions that you guys have. You know, we want to hear about what you're seeing, what you're getting involved with, because that's how we learn and we develop things that can help all of you.
So I'm curious, are you all of you starting to be asked for other parameters other than CO2 at this point? Yeah. One of the challenges, I think, with some of these IAQ sensors that you're starting to see on the market, you know, a lot of, there's several products out there that are offering 5, 6, 8 sensing points in one unit. And it's interesting. I kind of look at those, and to me, I kind of call them science fair projects because, you know, most of them don't have any connection outside of a cloud interface or an app interface on a phone. And, you know, they're meant to be placed on an office desk and let that person know if their office is okay or not. But it has no feedback into your ventilation strategies or anything. And then I look at some of these, right? They have everything in there: PM, CO, CO2, VOC, temp, humidity. Most of the specs are kind of lousy. They're, one of them that we've been dealing with has 8% RH as their accuracy spec. I'm like, well, you might as well just stick your finger out the window at that point. But like for PM, it's like, why would you necessarily want to monitor your PM levels at your desktop, right? To me, like the example we had, I'd rather be checking what my outside atmosphere is like before I decide if I'm going to bring stuff into the building or not. So I think, right, even the sensor industry is trying to figure out what's going on with it. It's interesting that you guys haven't had a whole lot of requests outside of CO2 at this point, but.
Would you like to begin to do a 5-4 ionization job? Some folks want to do the ion counting stuff, which is a little bit like letting the box be in charge of the in-house.
Right.
Yeah. You know, stuff in garages.
Yeah.
You know,
Yeah.
Application-specific.
Yeah. Well, the PM could be a handy secondary check on those ionization systems, right? Because the theory is that it's creating particles heavy enough that they just drop out of the airstream. So the PM won't tell you if, unless you go down to PM 0.1 to tell you if germs, bacteria, or viruses are in the airstream or not. But it could help point to how well that ionization system is working. And you know, you should be seeing a whole lot less particulates downstream at that point.
The maintenance and calibration particulate matter sensor sounds terrible. You know what I'm
yes.
I mean, like, okay, well, this is gonna work great this week.
And yeah. Right. I mean, there right now there is no field calibration of those types of devices, right? A TVOC sensor is such a broadband sensor that what do you calibrate it to? Yeah. Yeah. So it's a, we do, we do. So it's, I was gonna say similar to NDIR for CO2, but really, so it uses a laser scattering technique. And so there's an air chamber similar to the NDIR chamber of your pulling your atmosphere through it. So every unit has a little mini fan on it to have that constant airflow go through the PM unit. That helps keep the optical chamber clear, but you know, if you're in a really dirty duct system or you know, let's say you're close to ground zero of a wildfire, over time, particles are just gonna collect in there, dirt and dust is gonna collect in there, and then your sensors are gonna become off. Yeah. Yeah. You know, and they'll give you life expectancy. You know, I think PMs are around 8 to 10 years, but it's also what's your environment, right? And there really is no good bump test. I've suggested to people, right, you could bump test them briefly by lighting a match, blowing it out, and let the smoke, and you should see the PM spike. And you should see a TVOC sensor spike as well, and then clear. So that's kind of your poor man's bump test for, you know, is it still functioning at least? But TVOC. Yeah, yeah, that would work on PM. I'm not sure, it may or may not work on TVOC depending on what that chemical makeup is. Yeah.
Here you go. You can get kids, and then buy the special bottles, whatever
you
test.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You do. Yeah. You do have to be careful with the VOC sensors because, and most of them on the market these days are metal oxide sensors. That's the technology being used in them. And you can poison them pretty easily. We've poisoned several of them in our office because we're using, you know, spray cleaners, right? We'd spray it on a tissue and hold it underneath there. Well, at one point, someone didn't think that it was reacting fast enough, so they sprayed more in the general area of it, and it poisoned the sensor. So it yeah. Yeah. So right. It did a lot of good that one did, and yeah. And then you know. Yeah. Yeah. And we've had interesting conversations about displays, right? The whole CO2 alarming information. It goes back to TVOCs as well, and right. I think most of the customers that we have sold these sensors too, right? They're using it as secondary monitoring to fit into their analytics package. Nothing's going directly into their control algorithms, which makes sense. But most of them these days don't want any visual indicators on like their TVOC sensor. They don't want to deal with the questions, right? From Maya, who can't stand Glade plugins.
But everybody else was like, we're fine. So I just am sensitive, I guess.
Right. So. But at some point there has to be that explanation and communication back to those occupants to give them that level of understanding, that level of comfort, right? Whether it be through Commander and creating your own air quality dashboards, or finding other mechanisms to display something in a lobby, or let people pull something up on a phone to see, you know, even having them see the trending over time and realizing, oh, so ventilation kind of does this, but for the most part, I'm in the okay, clear categories, right? To give them that feedback, but I think some of that burden falls on us to be able to explain and educate them, but people who have no idea about our industry on what all this stuff means.